So one of the challenges for the youth is that I was told that, for example, when they go and seek a feedback or some sort of a positive reinforcement, usually that they feel that people don't help them. And they usually kind of fail, they fail to get any help sometimes from people around themselves. And they put them down because they might not believe in their ability. They don't see the potential. And the feedback the young people get is that this is a sort of reflection on me, on my potential and maybe the failure. So as a result of a negative feedback that they sometimes receive from them, from the environment that they live in, very funny effect here in these pictures, what they do is they set very low goals. They end up having very low self-esteem, and they don't believe in reality that they can achieve in life much. Now, what is very important to realize that these sorts of misunderstanding in terms of power dynamics in any relationship is not only within, let's say, young people and their teachers, but it's in every relationship that we have, between couple, between people who work together, between you and your boss, or you, people that work for you. In any sort of relationship, in organization, any kind of structure, you have sometimes what develops is person is just receiving. They are not able to contribute. They feel a little bit intimidated and they don't get the right feedback or opportunity to contribute. It is very, very critical to understand that when we look at the people, they come in all different shapes and sizes. They are like money in reality. That's why Prophet ﷺ said that people are minerals of gold and silver. Those who are best before Islam are best in Islam. And the souls are like a scattered soldiers. They cluster around the similar ones. So if the people are like a mineral and the gold, what this tells us is that they bring different qualities, the value. Clever people add value that is disproportionate to them being single individual. You could have a money representing $1 and money representing $100. Amount of value that they bring on the table is disproportionate. The very important aspect of this is that much of these things can be trained. There are certain tendencies that we have, but much of what we are and who we can be trained. And that's a good news. So we start by being gold or silver, but these things can change. So is that mine? Of course, we have people who, when you look at them, so as we said that you have people who are like a gold and like a silver, you have people who, when you look at them, they look like they are gold, but in reality, they are just like something that needs support. Anything comes against them, because they are hollow inside, they feel it's against them. And this is usually quality of losers. Any echo, because they're empty inside, there is the voice that fills them in. And they think that anything is against them. This is, on the contrary, when you look at the real people, a real man. And we have to understand that these real men are rare. In fact, they are as rare as strong camels that are able to persist, carry the load on their long trips. So you can hardly find one in 100. This is how the people are, men or women. The quality of them is different, just like gold and silver. There is Arab old saying that says, devoted men can revive a nation. Who are these people? Look at a few examples. Abu Bakr once sent one of the companions, Kaka, to Khalid, and he said, just his voice in a battle is equal to 1,000 other fighters. The army, having men like a Kaka, cannot be defeated. What sort of people are these? What mentality do they bring on the battlefield, in the organization, in the movement, in the nation? How do they, is it their physical strength? Is it something unusual about them? It's not. It's the mindset, the way they see life, the way they see things, the way they respond to opportunities around themselves. In fact, we know also that in the time of conquest of Egypt, Amr ibn As asked for reinforcement from Umar, and he wanted to complete from 8 to 12,000, because we know army with 12,000, it's very difficult militarily to defeat it. It's very compact unit. So Umar sent him four men. So he said, these four are like 4,000. Allahu Akbar. Four people like 4,000. This has to inspire us. How do we get to that stage where one is equal to 1,000? One day, Umar was sitting in a gathering like us today. And he asked companions, make a wish. Like we're sitting today and we want to buy HIVC, we want to have millions of dollars, we want to establish Khilafah, we want to fight everybody and conquer and be everything we want. Have services, have everything. Okay. So he said, thinking about this in the background, what we want to achieve, what we need, what's the usual response people need? Oh, hey, Charlie, we need $4 million. That's the first thing comes to the mind. We cannot do it unless we have $4 million. So the companions were the same. When Umar asked them, make a wish, they said, I wish, like this, you see this room, full of gold. Okay. He says, make a wish. Umar again insisted. Another one thinking, okay, what's better than gold? Jewels, diamonds, all of these things, gems. He says, I wish full room of these things, more value. Then Umar again said, make a wish. I said, we don't know what to wish for. We don't know what else to wish. He says, O leader of believers, what can we else think of? And then Umar said, I wish this whole house room full of men like such and such, Abu Dayda bin Jarrah, Muaz ibn Jabal, Salim, and so on. Why did he make such a statement? Because he understood the previous point we are talking about. What is the real resource of any community? What is the real resource? A resource that utilizes all of the other resources. A resource that brings all of the other resources in the right way. It's a man. A real man. These men, they are the backbone of society. They reform society. They bring back the honor to the society. They bring the resources at the end of the day. You don't have to be companion, you know, living with all of your experience. You can start as a child having the certain mentality of the upper hand. As this is very, very well known narration, when Umar was passing by a playground, like a road or something like that, and he saw some of the children. Of course, Umar being Umar, everybody ran away immediately as they see him. Now, why did these kids run away? Like our kids, you, as soon as you move to that section, they all run away. They know they are in trouble. They don't know why, but they know they are in trouble. But Abdullah ibn Zubair, he was calm and he remains sitting while all the other kids run away. So Umar asked him, how come you didn't run away? He says, oh, leader of the believers, I wasn't doing anything wrong in order to be afraid of you. And the road is not narrow. So there is, you know, Yani, there is enough room for you to pass. What do you want me to do? He was not intimidated. Look at the heart of the young boy. Not intimidated. Certainty. I'm doing the right thing. Why should I back down? You think when this boy is a general, a leader, that he's going to behave any other way except by his conviction? You see, that is that upper hand mentality. That is the mentality we want. He understands relationship. He understands what he's doing. He understands what you want. You want a pass. He understands power dynamic. He is not intimidated just because you are a leader. So if he is in the organization, he will add his contribution. When he needs to speak, represent community, he will not be lower hand that just apologize and go around and never confident, never showing any spine, never showing any backbone. He will do what needs to be. He will be the man of the Ummah. This is what we see, this upper hand mentality. We see in many companions. Abdurrahman ibn Auf, when he came as a migrant, like most of us, to Medina, he displayed this by not accepting charity from other people, using his own skills to establish himself, going to the market and starting something. Now, this quality of starting something, not depending on other people, it's what is the entrepreneurial quality of the companions. Very critical leadership skill. In Surah Al-Waqiyah, we see, accordingly, division of people according to this mindset, according to the action they perform. So it is says that, if you read Ibn Kathir, it says that this surah brings some people up and brings other people down. So one of the first of these three categories that we're talking about is the companions, ashab, of the right. Of course, what means the right is people who get a book in their right hand. So who are these people? They are people of paradise, isn't it? Are these all of these people people of paradise? Yes, they are all people of paradise. But are all people of paradise from them? They are not. Second, of course, we have people of the left who will receive their book of left, and they are people of hellfire, and these are all in the hellfire. But there is a third category, sabiqun and sabiqun. Who are these people? Who are those people who are forerunners? First, always first. Who are these people that are described? That these are the ones who are the nearest to Allah. They are also people of the right hand. They are also people of this, but as Ibn Kathir said, they are their chiefs, their leaders. Okay? What makes them different than these other people? What makes them so special? Now, this third category is not just simply on the right side, but they are higher level of the right side. What they do differently is they respond with the action. For what? For the call, to compete. So when Allah says, and march forth, or race with one another, what do? They don't start intellectual discussion, Facebook group, and you know, how exactly, do they know? They initiate an action. There is a motion. Things don't just remain still. They move. They move. Now, what does that mean, they move? They take an opportunity. Allah is presenting them with a gift. Opportunity to grow. Opportunity to earn reward. And what is the reward? It's forgiveness and the gardens in paradise. So this action here has specific rank, specific status, and specific reward. And it is for those who performed and respond to this call, and they in fact outperform others. They are outperforming others. Now this mentality becomes their habit. See, so sabiqun is sabiqun. They are first, and they are always first. They always find these people first. We want to do something together, they will be there, first one. You want to give, they will be the first one. You want to take, they will be the first. You want anything you can think of, they are always there. And we know that in any organization, in any movement, in any country, these people always there. They don't just let things go by without them being involved, being active. Okay, look at this. Sometimes people think, oh, we talk always the men and men and men. What about women? Let me give you this amazing story. Amazing story. You know, one day Prophet ﷺ was visiting someone and he fell asleep. While he was sleeping in that house, he started laughing in his dream. So the woman, Umm Haram there, she was observing him laughing. So when he woke up, she asked him, O Messenger of Allah, what caused you to laugh in your dream? Okay? So he told her what he saw. He said, some of my followers in his dream were presented to me fighting in Allah's cause on a board of a ship. And when he saw them like a kings on the thrones. Now imagine the vision. We are talking about people in the desert. They don't, what ship you're talking about? We don't have a naming ship or something. He's talking about fighting, not just fighting, fighting on a ship. Like, it doesn't exist. We are not even contemplating this. We are in Medina, what ships, what? Imagine the vision. And not just fighting, but they were like a kings on the thrones fighting. So, what do you think this woman said after hearing such a story? Look at the response. Look at the understanding. He says, can you invoke Allah that He makes me one of them? Amazing. Look at dedication, initiative. First, always first. So Prophet ﷺ went to sleep again. He was again smiling. The story repeated itself again. She asked the same question again. And he says to her, you will be amongst the first one. See? See that? This happened that during the time of Muawiyah, when we had built the navy capabilities and the army went to Cyprus and took it over and so on, she was amongst them. And what happened to her? She fell down from a riding animal and died. But look at that. Look at that racing mentality. Racing for goodness. Racing to good, do something. Vision. Initiative. Mindset. What I want it. I want that. There's something unbelievable. I want it. So these high caliber people, these are the people really that can hold the focus on what is truly important. They don't get down, bogged down in trivial matters. See, they know what their duties are and how to discharge this responsibility. One of the qualities that they have, that they are able to make decisions. Sometimes we can't even decide which t-shirt to buy until we consult 50, phone a friend, call this. We can't make a decision on t-shirt. Simple decisions, takes hours. Take hours. This is mental fitness. You know, when you decide, as the word itself means, its meaning of the word to decide is to make a cut, to cut off, to cut rival points that are competing for your attention. So when you do that, when you cut off, what it implies? Implies painful choice and action. It implies the action, but painful. You need to cut down. Now the higher quality people, the way that they focus on the high quality decision cause them that their decisions translate into actions. For example, I tell you on the basic level, what does that mean in your life? Let's say you have a child. If that child can now decide to do homework instead of play, let's say watch TV, what do we understand from that child? If you can continue, if you are a student, if you can do your assignment on time versus the last day, and you can leave the Facebook and emails and things like that, that shows us something about your focus, your ability to make a decision. your ability to take and hold responsibility. I know if I give you the task in a jama'ah or organization, you will not let me down. I want to have you next to me on the battlefield of the real battlefield or the life battlefield or any other battlefield that we are fighting of ideas or a soft or a hard power. That means you will not let me down. You will not continue playing while I need you, for example. You are able to maturely look at your situation. If you are at work, you are working. You are not wasting time in something else. So this, more than any other ability and the skills, determine your ability to focus and achieve and strive and how serious you are. Now, it's a time we step up and man up in terms of our responsibilities, face our problems. It's a time when we cannot afford any more like what we are doing until today. Things around us that are happening are not conspiracy theories, my dear brothers and sisters. We are so much into conspiracy theories. And these conspiracy theories paralyze our action. In fact, only weak people use conspiracy theories to justify their lazy mentality. You see, how are you going to know it's conspiracy or reality? You look what that person is doing. If there is no action and they're just talking, that's a conspiracy theory. They made themselves believe into some kind of parallel reality. Oh, this is what's happening. I can't do everything. And I therefore justify my inaction. I can justify and live with myself. You understand? So this is something that is very dangerous. Often these people see themselves like this. And we sometimes all see ourselves like this. Giant, mighty ship sailing through the seas, taking, conquering. Unfortunately for many of us, reality is more like this. You know, we live in our own bubble, surrounded with our few friends, with the same mindset, stimulating each other, little pond of water, we are moving, we are making delusional feeling like we are talking a big talk because we have few people on Facebook listening and clicking and stuff. Nobody cares, Ahi, what you're talking about. You are not affecting. You have to wake up. You have to wake up. Now, we have so much resources in our country, so much intelligence and clever people to waste on these sort of activities. So what these people need to do? What do we need to do? It has to start from a basic. It has to start from the basics. You have to get active, get involved. You see, when people are not active and they lose this hope, very easy to lose these days. What is the first thing that happens when they lose hope and they look at themselves and they maybe have an emotional argument with somebody or organization or a people or society or something like that? This anger and emotional instability, insecurity turns into the bitterness and goes inside their heart. So this initially disagreement or emotion, just like when husband and wife separate, or when you have a fight with somebody, your friend, this emotional first disagreement turns into the bitterness. More you think about it, more you focus on it, what's going to happen? It's going to kill your heart first and those around yourself. So the cure to fix your heart and bring that optimism is to create emotion. You move. Start something. Why would you start something? Because by doing action, you are developing your core abilities, your strength. This is how muscle gets developed. You hit a gym. Okay? By exercising, your mental muscle gets developed to make decisions, to make hard choices, and so on. So what we need, all of us, is to think about the future. Do we have specific point of view, world-changing thing? Now, it could be any number of things. Last year, we talked about us as a society, for example, in Australia, where we live, and most of the people are youth. Medium age for Muslim 1.6 billion people is 24 years old. Here, less than 60, almost 70% of the people in Australia are less than 35 years old. So we need to think about these things. Think about this reality. Our median age in Muslim countries, in the Muslim world, is 24. Other people, 40. By 2030, we'll be 2.2 billion. Median age will be 30. Other, 44. What does that mean? In the types of a services economy that we need, in terms of the things we want. We need everything, from entertainment, to the schools, to the media, to the financial institutions, anything you can think of, we need people, and people who will bring this from theoretical into the real life. And let me give you an example how some people are doing it. Look at this attitude. This is a school in Israel. I found this in a Startup Nation book. Fantastic piece of literature written by two Zionists to propagate Israel as the destination for business people. They were talking about a school in Israel that was started by Russian immigrants. These people came there and had a plan to populate Israel with quality people. These Russians, many of them had PhDs and everything. In this particular school, one of the security guard, when they brought them, they couldn't employ everyone. One of the security guard, he had PhD in maths. Of course, the jobs were taken, he can't do anything. What he does when school is locked in the night, he started tutorial classes in maths. Soon after that, school realized the genius of this guy and what the students are achieving as a result of this. They emerge his theory in teaching with a school and they make combined school. Soon after that, school is the top in Israel. Look at that, passion of one person. PhD is his security guide. Okay. Soon after that, the school is visited by founders of Google, two of them. Sergey Brin and Larry Page. So the students couldn't believe their eyes what these people are doing in their school until he started talking in Russian to them. Then they realized he's like us. And he says, my parents are also from Russia. I went at age such and such to US and my Jewish parents also, education and all of these things, they built this mentality in my head, competitive mentality. And I heard also that your school won 7 out of top 10 places in maths competition in Israel. The class erupted, they started clapping, you know. Thank you for acknowledging. But I said, this is not what I wanted to tell you. I want to tell you what my father told me and what he would ask here. He said, he would say, what happened to those other 3? You see that? You see what just happened? Paradigm shift. We're shifting the way we're looking at things. When is enough? When is enough? As Ahmed Ibn Hanbal said, it's never enough until our first foot is in the paradise, in Jannah. That's when it's enough. What these people are saying, forget these 7. Why did we fail in another 3? 100%. And this is a school in the poorest area. Now, we are migrants. We are sometimes here. We have stabbing every week, killing, rape by Muslim, killing by Muslim. Every day we have. Just last week we have the guy in Muni Pond, Muslim killed 2 because they didn't pay him for a plaster job. Here in mosque here, we have rapes by Muslims. We have all of these things by these. What is going on? This is, we have in the same problem that they used to have. But what did they build from this? What we talk about, high quality people. They don't even have a roads in this village, but they have this school. There was a study done according to output, you know, universities are measured by output, academically they produced. Between 70 and 2000, they measure all of the economic journals outside of US. They found number 2 country in terms of output is UK. And they have top university. London Business School is the top in the world, Oxford and Cambridge. So combined input classified UK number 2. The third position was Germany, almost 50% less than them. What was the number 1 country? Israel. Not by 5 or 10%, by 7 folds, 700% above UK. You see this dedication, passion, heart, people, You see what they produce? This is what they produce. Look at us. In 2005, Harvard University produced more scientific paper than 17 Arabic countries combined. We want to kid ourselves, joke ourselves, things just conspiracy. People put a hard work. They put a heart. They sacrifice. They don't sit, wait for somebody to give them permission to change the world. They take it. In the last 2 decades before 2000, Saudi Arabia had 171 patent innovation. Egypt 77, Kuwait 52 and so on. Israel 7,600. They people outsource calls to India, IT to Ireland, and brain to Israel. Brain to Israel. See, these people don't even in the war stop Intel factory functioning. So that people don't know, even we have a war, our factory will produce. After they finish 18 years of life, they enlist in military, and if they don't re-enlist again, half of them go to university and half remain in the top university, which is military university, the highest in the world. How do we transfer this mentality? You have to understand, it's not about knowing more theory. It's about working. It's simple as that. You want a theory, you want to build muscle by reading about it, you have no idea what you're doing. We don't need more theory and stuff. You, if you truly believe that you have it in yourself, first people, you must believe in yourself to the degree where it causes at least yourself to act. If you cannot convince yourself to make an action in the movement, how can you convince the people? In fact, by blaming people why they are not following you, shows that you yourself don't have a guts to believe in yourself and make a first move. That's why our scholars, like Sheikh Haitham and Haddad, he wrote a very interesting book about himma, high aspiration. And he told that spiritual and political strength of a Muslim is come from two. One is ilm, knowledge, and another one is this himma, high aspiration. Now we talk about knowledge a lot. What we don't talk about is aspiration. And Ibn Qayyim said that ham is the beginning of an action and the himma is the end of your action. What is the difference is, the first one is when your heart decides to perform. And the second one refers to the direction, the course of action. So why we don't have it? It's very simple. If we don't have these things, we have to look at ourselves. Laziness, whisperings of shaitan, and following our own desires. So what I want you to take away is that you have to understand it is within your grasp to change things around yourself. You can do that. Now your past does not equal your future. You see, things that happened in the past happened. You can work on things, okay? Just before we finish, look at this amazing conversation that happened between few very well-known leaders in our history. They were sitting and they were discussing. So they ask each other, wish for something, like we sit here, we drink coffee, mint tea and nana and all of that. And they say, wish for something. So the first one amongst themselves, I wish the rule of Iraq and to be married to this and that. Okay? The second one, he said, I wish to be proficient in fiqh and be a narrator of hadith. And he, both of them attained these things. The third, Abdul Malik, he said, I wish to be Khalifa of the Muslims. And he attained it. And the last one said, I wish the garden in paradise. Look at the conversation for a second. First of all, look at the companionship. What did we say in the beginning? The souls are like a soldiers who are scattered. They cluster around similar ones. We tend to be around people that are similar to us. You want to improve yourself? Number one, Choose your companions who have open mind. They are not narrow-minded. They don't look an excuse and everything. Who want to do things. They say you are the sum or the average of the five people you communicate the most. Take your Facebook account, your mobile phone, see who are the top five people you talk to. You will be the fifth and you will be the average amongst all of them. You want to change? Change that. Look at these people. They didn't think of these goals now and then. Look at this one. He even knows the name of the woman he wants to marry. You ask the brother today, brother, what do you want? Oh, I don't know, you know, I want to find a job. Which job? I don't know, whatever. What do you want else? Oh, marry anybody, nobody, anywhere to, I have no idea. And then on the Facebook, he become warrior for everything. Don't kid ourselves. Let's not be little children here. See, these people, they are working for this. It's in their heart. It's in their mind. They are already competing for this. They are striving for these things. It's very clear what they want. And they are not just simple, oh, you know, I want just a little bit of this. No, look at him. He wants to be Khalifa. He wants to rule Iraq. He wants to be this. It's not a small goal. So you want to do the same thing. Amongst us must be people who will dream big, strategically play this game on much higher level and much higher mentality. They need to trust who they are. You see, our youth, they have a fire in their heart. They have fire. They want to do something. The way to do and take it to the next level is they must start with a simple action. Start something. Start anything. Help one person. Just one person. Build then your system, your understanding by building one person. Develop your skills. Develop the mentality. If you really do all of these things, if you truly apply yourself and you put your attention and intention in the things, it's amazing how things can change. And the most important thing that will change is yourself. Change yourself, you already changed the world. The world is not anymore the same place. So this is my advice for you. Inshallah, may Allah forgive us if we said something that is wrong. I want you to think strategically, innovatively. We have issues in our community that we need to solve. We have huge tasks. We have huge challenges. And as one sheikh said, you know, if we leave the milk out of the fridge, it will spoil the milk. Environment is such that either you affect it or it will affect you. So think about these things. How can we build this environment? What can you do specifically? How can you start? How can you connect yourself with the people who are like-minded? So thank you very much for that. I'll leave it at that, inshallah. Allah reward you. Assalamu alaikum.